In this video, we're going to learn how to compute the derivative of a power function. In other words, a function of the form x to the n, and we're only covering the case where n is a natural number, in other words, a positive integer. Now we will eventually be able to extend our results to zero or negative integers, and in fact, any rational or any real number. But this is our starting point. N is just a positive integer. And before we get into our derivation here, I just want to give a quick reminder of some previous results. We've actually computed some derivatives of power functions already. So the simplest one would be the derivative of x. So I wrote it in Leibniz notation as d dx of x. Well, that's a power function because implicitly there's an exponent of 1 on that. And this turned out to be 1. Next, we'll look at the derivative of x squared. Again, this is another one that we've already done by directly using the limit definition of the derivative, and this turned out to be 2x. Finally, we computed the derivative of x cubed by using the limit definition of the derivative, and that turned out to be 3x squared. And so it's a little bit tricky to see a pattern here, but there is sort of a pattern emerging here. And what we notice is the number that was in the exponent of the thing we differentiated ends up out in front of the result. And then it looks like the exponent on x is reduced by 1. So for the x cubed case, we moved a 3 out in front, subtracted 1 from the exponent. And the same thing is true for the x squared case. We move a 2 out in front, subtract 1 from the exponent, because x is the same thing as x to the first power. And it even works for the n equals 1 case, where if I differentiate this, I put a 1 out in front and then subtract 1 from the exponent, because x to the 0 is the same thing as 1. So it looks like this pattern is going to generalize, where if we differentiate x to the n, we'll move that exponent out in front and write n times x, and then subtract 1 from the original exponent, and we end up with nx to the n minus 1. I'm going to put a question mark on that because that's not a proof. We're just sort of recognizing the general pattern here. So to actually get a proof of a new property of derivatives, we have to go back to the limit definition of the derivative. That's the limit as h goes to 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x, all divided by h. And I'll post a link at the top to the video where that was first derived by looking at the slopes of secant lines on an interval whose width was shrinking. And so all we have to do is plug in our specific function into this limit definition. So f of x plus h is obtained by replacing x with x plus h in the formula for our function. So I get x plus h to the nth power, where n is some positive integer. Okay, then I subtract f of x, which is just x to the n, and then we divide the whole thing by h. And now we get to the challenging part. How do I raise a binomial to the nth power? So we've got to make some progress on this binomial raised to the nth power, where n is some positive integer. This means we multiply this binomial by itself n times. So really what we're looking at is a string of binomials that are all multiplied together. And now we have to remember, like, how do we multiply polynomials together in general? And we're so used to just multiplying two binomials and then using FOIL, standing for first, outside, inside, and last terms. But the generalization is that when you multiply polynomials together, you have to find every possible product containing one term from each of the polynomials. And then we add all those together and we get the expansion of this product. So using this kind of thinking and then kind of organizing myself so that I start with the highest power of x, I see that the term with the highest possible power of x is obtained by selecting the x from every single one of these binomials. Again, what we want is a list of terms obtained by taking every possible product containing one term from each binomial. And if we select the x from every single binomial, this is going to give us an x to the n because we have n binomials lined up in this product. So that's how the expansion begins, and then it starts to get more interesting. In the next term, I want to look at all the ways I can get an x to the n minus 1. And we can do that by selecting the x from every single one of these binomials except for one of them where we choose the h instead. So in our picture, we have just one specific case where instead of choosing an x, I chose an h in my second binomial. Now, when I multiply all of these terms together, x's from n minus 1 binomials and an h from one binomial, I end up with a term that looks like x to the n minus 1 multiplied by h. But that was just one way to get a term that has an x to the n minus 1 times h in it. And here's another way to do it. I could pick the h from my third binomial and pick x's from all the others. And now this is turning into kind of a counting problem. I really just have to ask myself, how many ways are there to pick an h from one of these binomials? And because there's n of them, I'm going to end up with n terms that look like x to the n minus 1 multiplied by h. So combining all those like terms together, I get n of these. And the second term of our expansion is nx to the n minus 1 multiplied by h. And this is already encouraging because we've recognized that form nx to the n minus 1, but we have some more details to get through. In my next term, I'm going to have x to the n minus 2, meaning I've chosen the x from n minus 2 of these factors. That's all of them except for two of them. And there's a picture of just one way this could happen. I could pick the h from the first binomial and the third binomial, and then pick the x's from all the rest of them. And when I multiply all those terms together, I end up with an x to the n minus 2 times h squared. But now I have to count up all the possible ways there are to pick two of these binomials to take the h's from. And now this is crossing over into combinatorics, in other words, the mathematics of counting. How many ways are there to pick two things from a set of n things? And there's actually a special notation for this. That's pronounced n choose two, as a reminder of the process we're doing here. We're trying to choose two binomials from a set of n, and there's a lot of ways to do this. Now, the point of this video is not to go into the details of how to count combinations. The main point here is that this term has an h squared on it, and that the next term is going to have an h cubed on it. So real quick, the next term would look like n choose 3, the number of ways of choosing three things from a set of n, times x to the n minus 3 times h cubed, and so on. And so each one of those remaining terms on the right end is just going to have more and more factors of h in it. This process terminates, by the way, by choosing h from every single binomial and getting an h to the n at the very end. So if we go back to our limit representing the derivative of this original power function, the expansion of my binomial raised to the nth power, just the first couple terms here, is going to be x to the n plus nx to the n minus 1 times one factor of h plus a bunch of terms that have more than one factor of h in them. And then we're going to subtract x to the n from that, divide by h, and take the limit as h goes to 0. Now the x to the n's are going to cancel out. One of them is positive and one is negative. And then I'm just going to divide every term in the numerator by this h. And the first term there ends up with no h on it anymore. That's just nx to the n minus 1. But the rest of my terms have at least an h squared in them. So when I divide one h out of them, they also have at least one h in them. And there's a clever way we can write this to highlight the important feature here. I can say there's still at least one h I could factor out of the rest of the stuff in this sum. So we'll just say the rest of the sum could be represented as h times a bunch of other stuff. Now when I take the limit as h goes to 0, that whole right tail of this series is gone. And what we're left with is just this first piece, which is a constant with respect to the h limit, and I get nx to the n minus 1. Now when I'm writing down derivative rules, I like to do it in Leibniz notation. I think it's just a little cleaner that way. So our conclusion here is that the derivative, so d dx, of x to the n is equal to nx to the n minus 1. And I want to take a moment to just appreciate how powerful this is to derive a general formula like this. Now we had to use the limit definition of the derivative to get to this point. But once you've solved this problem in general, we don't ever have to go back and use a limit to compute a derivative of a power function again. Instead, we figured out there's this simple algebraic manipulation that you can do to a power function that automatically gives you the derivative, in other words, the function telling you the slope of x to the n at any point. And to me, this is the moment that we first start to realize what we're doing here is building an exotic new algebra that tells us the way this derivative operator, this complicated idea of finding the slope of a function, it tells us the way this derivative operator interacts with a bunch of different classes of functions. Again, the weird result here is to differentiate a power function, you just take the original exponent and move it in front, and then you subtract 1 from the original exponent, and you've automatically got a derivative, no need to compute a limit. So now we can apply our new formula to a couple simple examples, and I'm just practicing a couple different notations here. In the first one, we have the Leibniz notation for the derivative, so I've written d dx of x to the 100th power. That just says take the derivative of x to the 100th, and we don't have to compute a limit. We can just use our power rule. We bring down the original exponent in front, subtract 1 from the original exponent, we get 100 x to the 99th, and we're done. In our next example, we're just using Newton's notation for the derivative, in other words, the prime notation. And note that it's a little more cumbersome because I have to say let f of x equal x to the 6th, and then find f prime of x. In other words, take the derivative. And again, just using the power rule that we figured out, we take the original exponent out in front, subtract 1 from the original exponent, and we've immediately got the derivative. In the next video, we're going to learn how to take the derivative of a linear combination of two functions. I've posted a link to that video at the upper left of the end screen. There's also a link to my derivative playlist at the lower left of the end screen, and I'll see you there.